Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've talked all about cash and receivables. We've talked about how we can use financial accounting to help control cash and reduce the likelihood of theft. And then we've talked about receivables in all kinds of detail. We've talked about how you issue them, how you collect them, both accounts receivable and notes receivable. We've talked about presenting the net present value and using the percent of sales and percent of receivable method. We've talked about using accounts receivable and notes receivable as collateral and factoring them and selling them off so we don't have to deal with collections. And even though we didn't mention it last time, let me mention now that factoring of notes receivable works exactly the same way as the factoring of accounts receivable. The only difference is, if it's long-term notes receivable, we probably don't have an allowance. Now in this segment, we just need to take a few minutes and wrap up our discussion by talking about a few last details. And here they are. There are a lot of things we have to think about as we consider reporting accounts receivable and notes receivable in the financial statements. So keep in mind, you should have accounts receivable in one account or one line item, notes receivable in a separate line item, unless it's immaterial. If you remember, immaterial means that a normal rational investor would not change his or her decision by having it broken out as opposed to having them lumped together. So if you have $1 million worth of accounts receivable and a $20,000 note, you can just lump them together, not a big deal. But if the numbers are similar in size and it might make a difference to people, then you need to break them out so your investors know what's going on. In addition, the allowance accounts need to be placed with the account that they apply to. So you don't want to have accounts receivable, notes receivable, all of the allowances lumped together. You want accounts receivable and the allowance for bad debts for accounts receivable, notes receivable and the allowance for bad debts for notes receivable. So you're going to keep those separate as well, just like you do with the actual accounts. In addition, make sure that we classify receivables based on how soon they'll be converted. Remember, current assets are going to be turned into cash within 1 year or operating cycle. If it's going to take you longer than that to get that accounts receivable or that note receivable, then they're not current assets, they're long-term investments, and you need to move them into the other category. It's not often we see accounts receivable in long-term investments, but a lot of times notes receivable are included in that other category. In addition to what goes into the financial statements, there's a lot of things we have to put in the footnotes about receivables. If there's any contingencies related to receivables, we have to disclose those. We may have to describe the fact that we just started a credit policy and we have no idea how much we'll be able to collect. We just took a random guess. Or we're not sure what default will do to us, etc. We have to talk a little bit about how we decided what portion will actually be collected. That's part of our contingency plan, is talking about, did we use percent of sales or percent of accounts receivable? What percentage did we use, etc.? We also need to disclose if we have designated or pledged our account receivables. So if they're collateral on a loan, then you need to have that in your footnotes so that your investors know this accounts receivable is going to be collected and go to pay this debt off, not provide us with cash we can use for something else. The last one here is if we think we've got significant credit risk. This doesn't happen often. Usually the allowance for bad debt takes care of this. But every once in a while, you'll have a company that grants credit to any and everybody without doing a significant credit check. And then they've got significant risk that they're going to be defaulted on, even more than their percentage or their estimate in bad debt expense, because they just haven't done the checking. This happens most often when you open up your credit policy. So I'm basing my allowance for bad debt on a percentage I've used for 10 years, but hey, I just decided to issue to those with a credit rating 100 points lower than I've ever accepted before. Well, now I do have credit risk beyond what's in my allowance because I just opened this up. In addition to how we disclose them, we have to be able to analyze our accounts and notes receivable. And the best way to do that are with a couple of key ratios. So the first one is the quick ratio. This is considered the best measure of what we call primary liquidity. Primary liquidity meaning being able to turn it into cash instantly. When we talk about a normal current ratio, we include prepaid expenses, we include inventory, and those things can take a while to turn to cash. But receivables, cash equivalents, and cash, those can be turned into cash very, very quickly. Cash is already cash. Cash equivalents, we said, have to be able to be turned into cash immediately. So stocks and bonds that are always being traded, they're almost cash as it is. And accounts receivable, I could factor if I had to. So I could turn those into cash really fast. Whereas prepaid expenses, I prepaid the expense. It's going to slowly be used up over the next year or 3 years or however long I prepaid. Inventory, I sell that at my normal rate, so I can't turn it into cash much more quickly. So that's what this quick ratio does, is it gets us away from the stuff that can't be turned into cash quickly, even though we think it'll be less than a year, and focuses on these really liquid accounts. And you can see the basic equation here. Cash plus cash equivalents plus accounts receivable, net, we take out the allowance for bad debt, and then divide by current liabilities. Now, there's really not a rule of thumb on this ratio. Current ratio, remember, we wanted right around 2-ish. Quick ratio depends on the industry and your past history, so it doesn't have that nice set percentage as a threshold. The other ratio we want to talk about is accounts receivable turnover. This is a measure of how quickly we turn our receivables into cash. And most of the time we think about this as accounts receivable, but you could do this for notes receivable as well, especially if they're a material part of your balance sheet. We don't see that very often though, so we're going to focus on just this accounts receivable turnover, and that's credit sales or net sales if you don't know the credit sales number exactly. We're going to divide by average net accounts receivable. So again, we're going to take out that allowance for bad debt. In this case, again, there's no rule of thumb, but bigger is usually better because it means we're turning things into cash much faster, and that's what we want to see. Whew, we've talked about a lot of stuff, haven't we? So much important information about accounts receivable and cash. There's just so much involved here in these liquid accounts, and we need to be comfortable with them in order to do a good analysis, in order to make good decisions, and in order to accurately report what's going on in our business. So we really need to be comfortable with this stuff. Now, when we come back, we're going to change gears just a little bit and start talking about inventory. Still a current asset, still extremely important to our business, since this is now what determines whether we stay in business over time, but a little different from the way we treat our receivables. So with that preview of coming attractions, I'll see you next time.